On the phone, it's a pleasure to welcome to the program freelance journalist, former cartoonist, and author of It Came From Something Awful, How a Toxic Troll Army Accidentally Memed Donald Trump into Office, Dale Beran. Welcome to the program.
Hi, thanks for having me.
So let's just start with your, I guess, you, well, let's start with something awful. What and maybe it will sort of walk us through your journey, how you got there, and then we'll talk about how society sort of set up the table for this particular brand of, I guess, this societal perspective, which brought us this toxic troll army. But
sure.
But tell us about something awful. Like, what was your involvement in that? What was that?
It was a website in the 90s. It still exists. It was a sort of toxic forum where there was sort of like the depth of kind of dark humor and 90s nihilism was expressed there. So it was about kind of self-hating gamers who would kind of make fun of dropping out and playing games and hating sort of this like commodified lifestyle where you're just sort of like hanging out, you've dropped out of life and you're very nihilistic. And that evolved, that spawned another site called 4chan, which was even more nihilistic and sort of even more, about, dropping out and playing video games all day. And that slowly evolved sort of into a political movement, first on the left, and then it spawned the far right. So that's sort of in a nutshell, that's what the book is about, tracing that history of the alt-right, which came out of this anime website or this sort of set of websites about playing video games and dropping out of life.
All right, so let's track that, how nihilism turns into a, I maybe hesitate to say a political movement, but certainly almost a strange political ideology of sorts. Just, I guess, tell folks like what, and I think most people by now know what 4chan and 8chan are, but
right.
what is 4chan and 8chan?
They are online message boards, anonymous for the most part, so you don't have to say who you are when you post, and they're sort of known first as sort of anime-themed message boards, but also known for really dark, cynical content. And they've spawned a variety of sociologically important things, like memes. They more or less invented the idea of memes. And then they invented then Anonymous, the sort of far-left hacktivist collective, came out of 4chan around 2008. And then they largely spawned the alt-right around 2014, 2015. So very large internet message boards that sort of, to me, I argue, are sort of the center of a sort of type of youth counterculture that then sort of evolves into political movements.
Now, the people, as you talk about these sort of different eras of 4chan, right? Anonymous and then Gamergate, I guess, and maybe
right.
The alt-right and whatnot. These are not necessarily the same people, right? They're different generations of people who are like adopting parts of the generation that was prior to them. And by generation, I'm using the term, I guess, maybe a little loosely or you know, a little specifically, not necessarily, although maybe we're speeding up in that way. But I mean, is that right?
Right. We, in some sense, I sort of use these sites to kind of make a sociological argument about sort of trends and sort of to understand the phenomenon of like why suddenly in 2015 there's this huge fascist movement on this very popular message board. But actually going out and speaking to people from the sites, people using the sites and going out and finding sources for the book, some of them are the same, right? Some of them kind of have gone through the whole thing. For the most part, the far left anonymous hacktivist group are different. So part of why the right far right movement spawned was there was a quote-unquote moral vacuum where all those people left. A lot of people grew up, left the site. But a lot of folks sort of, the idea is that you sort of had this vast disenfranchised group of people who were sort of ever more marginalized, right? Like after the 2008 crash, they were just sort of men that just dropped out. They never came back. And they ended up, well, in that case, you're on the internet, you're hanging out, and the people who were there in 2005 and were like, haha, I'm dropping out of life, I'm a Gen Xer, I'm like, life sucks, you know, then 20 years passes, right? And like the idea is that how long can you be a nihilist? How long can you do that? And the answer is not long, right? So at first they try the left. They're like, all right, well, we're going to break out of our mom's basements and we're going to have this hacktivist political movement that is going to destroy big, you know, a big government or the industrial complex or big corporations. But that gets crushed by the FBI around 2012. And there's still a lot of people left. And there's new kids, right? So the phenomenon of like, the idea that like, oh, you're 19, you're 20, and still life sucks. You get to be shuffled into a cubicle or you get to work at Taco Bell. Well, the idea of that, like video games and the internet, all that stuff's expanding. Those worlds are more enthralling than ever. So like that idea that 4chan invented that like in 2005, you'll drop out. The kids in 2015, they're like, yeah, more than ever, I'm going to do that. So then that culture gets inherited, right? So it's sort of like a rolling ball that just keeps going. Where like the phenomenon, the underlying phenomenon that created it is still there. So 4chan's culture just keeps ballooning and then creating new politics that float up to the political sphere.
Do we have an analog? I mean, because it feels like there is something structural about the internet and more narrowly, you know, like an existing message board, that we don't necessarily have an analog for past generations. So if and you start the book out talking a little bit about the counterculture in the 60s and how in many respects it became absorbed by the culture and then commodified and sold back to us in many ways, like The Gap, for instance,
right.
San Francisco. But it was very hard to maintain whatever feelings or attitudes there were from the late 60s, because there was no third place, if you will, where the dynamic was static. So, and maybe I'm not articulating that clearly enough, but that an unmoderated, self-maintained, almost, you know, online VFW hall, right? Where people could go, and there's obviously like some institutional memory of the attitudes that drove people there in the first place. You know, you've got a lot of misfits, you got a lot of people who are alienated, and this is a place for me to go where I can also sort of redesign who I am in some way.
Right.
It's almost as if, you know, Woodstock existed, never shut down, right? There was constantly rolling for years and years. Obviously, you know, that the ethos from the original Woodstock would live on longer. And it sort of feels like that's happened with 4chan. But the core basis of that ethos, which is like we live outside of things, was the only thing that changed. And sort of what filled it changed a little bit. But that core ethos of like, hey, we're in an unmoderated forum where we're outside of things. We're almost outlaws on some level, right? I mean, that seems to be the only thing that maintained through that period.
In some sense, yeah. I mean, I think that's an interesting point. And I agree. All those elements are there, right? The outsider, the rebel, the people that don't want to be part of society or sort of want to make their own rules, right? They'd always have that sort of independent streak. I mean, I guess to sort of put these things, touch on these things in the way that I order them in the book, the idea is that, well, as you sort of described, the internet was created by these out of this sort of 60s counterculture, and they're like, oh, the rebellion will be there, like Woodstock, the new Woodstock will be there. And then instead what occurred was, by the time the 80s and 90s roll around, there's sort of this idea that capitalism will last forever in the American style, that's sort of the end of history, the Fukuyama idea that like that was it. And then counterculture from the 90s, which was my generation, we said, oh, well, there's nowhere to go, right? There's only despair, only sort of dropping out and nihilism. And that became this sort of dropping out in the computer world. And so by the early 2000s, you sort of get that nihilistic youth counterculture. They're like, well, where are we going? We're just going in. We're just going to drop out. We're going to live in the screen. And the real world kind of sucks because it doesn't really offer us much. And sort of like what happened, that was 4chan. And so what then happens was by the time you get to 2008, they're like, they're ready to rebel. They're sort of ready to sort of take action and become hackers, sort of like in that revolutionary sense that was envisioned by the 60s. And they do. It really does happen on 4chan. But when that movement's broken, then sort of like what happens is you get another generation coming in, and they're like, well, now where do we go? We still have that sort of nihilistic idea. Like more than ever, they're sort of like, well, now there's even less hope for us. And that ends up sort of devolving into the alt-right. And but that also touches on the other point that you talked about where it's new, right? The new part is that there's sort of this echo chamber effect where it turns out sort of unique to the internet that if you get a bunch of people together, they're going to encourage really bad behavior among themselves. So whether that's sort of finspo inspiring to be sin or sort of incels and sort of where you're like, oh, we all get together and like, we're all going to decide that we're doomed. We're never going to go outside. We're never going to have romantic partners. Right. So there's sort of, that was the new effect, but the other part's very old, right? So like the idea that in 2015, 2016 and 2017, you get like young people becoming communists and young people becoming fascists and they're battling on the streets because capitalism once again has become so unequal and sort of so dysfunctional, right? That's old. It's just expressing itself again through the internet, through these weird forms that started out about anime.
does the idea, I mean, because we should talk about Gamergate. I mean, all of this fascinates me for multiple reasons. I mean, I was told when we first went on Air America, we had a website for the Majority Report, which was just an old movable type with just, you know, comments, but we wouldn't blog very much. It really just functioned as a completely unmoderated, you know, chat forum. And we would have anywhere from 20 to 30,000 people a day, mostly through those 3 hours and thousands of comments per hour because people, we were pushing people there from the radio site. And I had people who told me that some elements of Anonymous were, you know, would gather there because it was completely unmoderated and it moved quite rapidly and whatnot. And then, you know, 5 or 6 years later, I'm doing this version of the show and one of my producers at the time who was hosting, you know, wanted to talk about Gamergate, which I had no idea what it was. And I wonder,
why would you?
Well, I mean, I don't know.
Like at the time it was pure garbage, right? It's like, to me, it's like Dennis Rodman visiting North Korea, right? You're like, you just want to forget it. It's pure garbage.
But even then, less like, so, right?
And then,
I mean,
and then
tell
like
us
2 years later, you're like, oh, that's the imprint. That's like Donald Trump visiting. It's the same thing, right? Like
exactly.
It becomes historically important, right?
Exactly. And so, but I mean, there's two things that occur to me about Gamergate. And I want you to tell people what Gamergate was for folks who don't remember. And also the concept of incels. Because one of the things that really seems clear to me is that during this period of time, we have sort of this, you know, to borrow your phrase, a toxic brew of of one, a financial collapse, right? So you have people who are going through economic hardship, on top of which we're having fairly significant strides in social emancipation, if you will. We have the election of the first African-American president. We have we're hurtling towards marriage equality. We have the election came down to a woman and an African American man. Everyone anticipated that the next president would be a woman. So we're getting further, you know, sort of social emancipation. And it doesn't surprise me that on some level to be counterculture at this moment in time is to essentially be a conservative reactionary. And certainly there were those people who are trying to sort of build this ideology during the aughts, but it wasn't quite there because things were pretty, it was not clear where the culture was going in terms of this stuff. But by 2008, there was a sense of like, it's going in not the direction the conservatives of the George Bush movement had. So tell us what Gamergate came out of, because to me, as I've told people about it, it's like, I'm basically telling you a story that you probably encountered in junior high.
sure.
But it grew into something massive.
Right. So, yeah, it was sort of this piece of cultural garbage in 2014. It was sort of a harassment campaign that started on 4chan. So 4chan was part of this, or really the center of troll culture, where they would gang up and harass people. And that turned before into this hacktivist movement where they'd harass Scientology or a government. But in 2014, the people left there harassed a game developer, and the idea was they were insulted that she was bringing feminism to games, essentially. That was their complaint. There was a bunch of other hyper detail that's sort of not really relevant.
Well, but I do think this is relevant insofar as it was a guy who broke up with a girl, or a girl who broke up with a guy. And the guy...
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Created this narrative.
He was sort of a jilted ex or something, and he posted this long angry screed to kind of inspire the angry young men on 4chan. He knew this woman, Zoe Quinn, the game developer, was already being targeted already by sort of the incel community at that point. And so he sort of like wanted to rally them, so he created this long angry post, and he's like, these are all the horrible things she did. And it just became this huge harassment campaign, like bigger almost than any personal harassment campaign 4chan had ever done. And so the idea is like, well, where did all that passion come from? Why did they mobilize around that? And the idea was then full of young men who had really just dropped out in a way that was more than any other in the past, sort of more otaku, more hikikomori, is sort of the Japanese term for it, where you're just withdrawing, living life by the computer and convincing themselves that they would never go out, they would never have a romantic partner, they would never succeed in life, that they were on the bottom. And so this idea that like, oh, I can't go into a video game and then seduce a woman in the video game and sort of have these misogynistic fantasies in my video game, well, that's my only retreat. That's the only place I can go. So they got really mad. And this was their way, their really immature, kind of deranged way of expressing it. But that coalesced into a political movement. After that movement on 4chan, all these young men on 4chan and 8chan, they realized, oh, we have this sort of thing in common. We are similar. We don't like feminism. And at the time, what happened was, as the coalition was forming, there were sort of these hucksters on YouTube that would be like, oh, well, I'll be your mouthpiece. I'll speak for you. I'll be kind of like your stand-in dad for the young men living, like raising themselves on the internet. And that was Milo Yiannopoulos. That was Mike Cernovich. That was Sargon of Akkad, whatever. All these, like, sort of now it's a cottage industry of conservative YouTube dads kind of like raising these kids online. But like back then, that was sort of the first wave. They were gamer gators. And that just evolved. That was 2014. So 2015, Gamergate peters out. Trump starts.
Now, hold on for one second. Let me just say something about 2014. Yeah. So people understand how this grows. I mean, because it is an astonishing story that we're really talking about a guy who breaks up with a girl and then basically harnesses the misogyny that is existing, and they use to basically talk about this. It was literally, and I just remember this, that people were complaining about the lack of ethics in gaming journalism.
Yeah, that was their line, right?
They felt this woman was getting...
It was totally fabricated. It was nonsense, right? It turns out it was a typo in the guy's street. He thought the way that he wrote it, he's like, oh, maybe she sort of knew this guy that wrote a review of her game, but it turned out not to be true.
Right. It ended up being this whole notion of, but it's, I think it's important too, because it's relevant that it's an attack on the media. Now, I don't take gaming media seriously. I apologize. Gaming reviews, I know it's important, obviously, to people who read games, but this is setting up a structure of attacking an institution, which is the gaming media, to the extent that there was one. I think there was one. And like you say, there was a couple of YouTube hucksters who realized, if I cover this stuff and I become their champion, I'm going to make a lot of money and achieve a certain amount of celebrity. And that's exactly what happened.
Right. And, you know, the game media at the time, they knew for the most part, they're like, look, these companies have trained these young men to be consumers, right? Gamergate described itself as a consumer revolt. And the idea was like, we want this out of our product. We want this out of our game. And like the idea was that that's all they had, right? Their whole life was sort of defined by dropping out, kind of consuming stuff, mostly just online products at their computer, right? So it's like you can see how that lifestyle is nihilistic and sort of desperate and longing in that void for something, for someone to come in and then be like, well, let me give you 12 rules to live your life or whatever, right? Yeah. Like, right. It's like Peterson who replaced Yiannopoulos, right? Like, let me tell you how to pull yourself up by your boot. Let me give you an off the rack value system because you have nothing, because you're sort of living in this sort of like hyper nihilistic, unhappy life.
Indeed. And so we have that in 2014, and then it begins to, it feels like it begins to collapse under its own weight, right? Like the idea of ethics in gaming journalism only has so much durability. And now we're in 2015.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, what happens is that, yeah, it can't play out for long. So 2015, the same men who are on YouTube who are sort of purporting to be leaders of the movement, they need a new cause. And Trump is just starting his campaign. It turns out sort of Trump is uncannily sort of replicates their issues, right? They are young men who feel like they're on the bottom of society, and Trump's message is, oh, I'm gonna have you win so much you're gonna get sick of winning. Well, who is that message to but losers, right?
Right.
People are like, man, one day I'm really gonna win. Yeah, so it was people who were sort of disenfranchised, and before it hadn't been a political coalition. They were the margins of other political coalitions. But now it's sort of like, oh, these young men under 40 who had dropped out of life, well, we're going to sort of form our own coalition, and we're going to rally around this guy who looks like a loser outsider, but at the same time, he's sort of like projecting what they imagine is success in life, which is sort of like an alpha male, right? That's, they invented all this terminology where they imagined that like life was like a cruel competitive hierarchy and they're on the bottom. But the idea is like, oh, I win if I get to the top. And that's, of course, the same sort of like ideology that Trump holds, right? That he's like the I quote a philosopher, Hannah Arendt, who talks about the idea that like, oh, well, it's someone who would be flattered at being called a bloodthirsty animal, right? Like the idea that like you're a hyper competitive businessman and all my friends are rivals, right? So it's weird that the men at the bottom felt this, but in fact it was that same ideology that sort of drifted down to them, where they felt a union with those people like Bannon and Trump at the top.
Well, now that union with someone like Bannon was not necessarily a mistake, right? Because Bannon, and we should say, Bannon at this point is running Breitbart, essentially. He's getting funding, as far as I can tell, from the Mercers. That money may have been secured before Breitbart died. And Breitbart, I specifically remember, got about an $11 million infusion into the Breitbart site about a year before he died, somewhere around there, from some private firm, at a time where there was virtually no traffic on that Breitbart site. Breitbart, who believed that politics is down culture, or downstream, I should say, from culture, that infused the ideology of that site. So how did Milo end up at Breitbart? Did Bannon basically see this building and say, this is energy that we can use?
I mean, it's a crazy story, and you're right, right? So it seems like a grassroots movement at first, but whatever part was grassroots, Steve Bannon, at the head of Breitbart at the moment, in 2015, took it and spent all that Mercer money to promote it through Yiannopoulos, right? So Yiannopoulos had been at Breitbart a little bit earlier, so he was already writing for Breitbart when Gamergate hit, and then he sort of switched to Gamergate, so they had already met, and he'd already been hired. And the idea is that Bannon and Yiannopoulos learned about 4chan and 8chan and these groups through Gamergate. And by 2015, Bannon shares a lot in common with them, and I argue in my book he likes the same fascist philosophers that 4chan and 8chan were becoming enamored of, right? Like, he is into sword and sorcery. Like, his company is called Glittering Steel, right? He wrote these sort of hyper-masculine sort of video game style screenplays. So he loves this population, and he says, the quotes I have in the book are something like, he's like, these young, disenfranchised white males have monster power, and they come in through Gamergate or whatever, and now they're going to vote for Trump. So he gives Milo Yiannopoulos $1 million They meet at the Cannes Film Festival. Mercer, Bannon, and Yiannopoulos meet. They give Yiannopoulos $1 million, and they say, go on tour. And Yiannopoulos goes on a tour that he calls the Dangerous Faggot Tour, and this just ends up in the bloody riots and the sort of clashes with Antifa that we see in 2016 at the end of 2016, and then continuing, sort of snowballing and spiraling in 2017 until it ends in Charlottesville, which is sort of the last, most awful one. Though they still go on a little bit, but not as much.
And this is it's so stunning to me how this all came out of essentially the spark was essentially this guy getting jilted by a woman, and this the strength of this misogyny. And we should say too, like, the I've said this ad nauseum on this program, but there's a multitude of reasons why Hillary Clinton lost, but misogyny is certainly one of them. And to have this, so much of what is going on, at least online, a function of the misogyny.